Performance of your application frequently depends on the database you select for a specific task. As a developer, you may need to choose the appropriate database based on your use case and requirements. In this video, we'll go through the most common database types used in enterprises. I'll provide use cases when to choose a specific database, as well as examples of open source and cloud managed databases. Let's start with a relational database. Originally, it was developed by IBM in the 1970s. You can think of a relational database as a collection of spreadsheet files that help businesses organize, manage, and relate data. In the relational database model, each spreadsheet is a table that stores information represented as columns, attributes, and rows, records or tuples. Now, columns specify data types, and each record or row contains values corresponding to those specific data types. For example, in the customer table, you may have integer type for the ID column and varchar for the name and address. Also, in the relational database, each table has a unique identifier for each row called the primary key. Rows from different tables can be linked using a foreign key, which refers to the primary key in another table. Let's take a look at how the relational database model works in practice. Let's say we have a website and track every single action that a user may do. A user can click on the button, add an item to the shopping cart, and things like that. Now, in a very simplified version, we would have a customer table and event table. Each time a customer does something on the website, we would store it in the event table and use a foreign key to link the event to the customer. Also, we can use SQL to query our database. For example, you can use the following query to get all the customers you have. Now, if you want to get all the customers who are active, meaning they performed at least one action, you can use the following join. I have another video explaining all different joins as well. Another important feature provided by most relational databases is ACID transactions. This means all changes to data are performed as if they are a single operation. If at least one task fails, the whole transaction is rolled back. For example, consider a transfer of funds from one bank account to another. First, you need to check if there is enough money to transfer. Then you would debit one account and credit another. So if at least one step fails, you would want to roll back the entire transaction. Now, you would use a relational database for structured data and ACID compliance. Structured data means that you have rows and columns that clearly define data attributes. Some examples of relational databases are MySQL, PostgreSQL, MariaDB, Microsoft SQL Server, and Oracle Database. There are also some cloud managed databases available, such as Amazon Aurora, Azure SQL, and many others. Now, traditional databases do not scale very well. If you have a lot of data, like billions of records, traditional databases can be slow. To improve query performance with big data, columnar databases have been developed. Let's go through the simple exercise, which will help you see the power of using columnar databases for certain tasks. To illustrate this exercise, I'm going to use a spreadsheet populated with some customer data. First of all, let's see how a traditional database works. Before we start, there is a rule that we need to follow. We have to read the data from left to right, starting from the beginning of each row, and proceed from row to row, kind of like reading a book. So let's start. Let's ask traditional database to return all paying customers. Here it goes. As you read the data, notice that you're retrieving the name and tier on each pass of every row. And eventually, you'll acquire all the names and their associated tiers. Now, servers do this very quickly. However, what if my request involves several billions of rows? You can start to see that reading each row just to grab the name and tier columns could take a while. And this is where a columnar database comes in handy. We're going to redo the exercise one more time. But instead of using traditional database rules, I'm going to give you columnar database rules. This means you're going to read the data from top to bottom, and you're only going to read the columns that I ask you to. Now, let's ask the columnar database the same question to return all paying customers. Let's start. Notice that this method skips all the data that isn't related to what we're looking for. Once we have finished getting that information, we start with the next column, skipping the columns that we don't need. But wait a second, how does a computer know which tier to assign to each customer name it's retrieving? The way it does this is by having the columnar database assigned a number to each row of data, allowing it to quickly pair up different columns it retrieves. You can see how this really comes in handy when you start reading the name column. All it needs to know is the number where the name values ended. In this case, row 10. This means I just need tier rows from 1 to 10. Now, you probably noticed that the columnar database was repeating basic over and over. This is actually another advantage of a columnar database. By using the numbering system, columnar database can utilize algorithms to simplify data retrieval. And you'll find that each columnar database system has highly sophisticated methods for achieving further performance enhancements. So compared to traditional databases, a columnar database does not actually read billions of rows of data. Instead, it just reads a few long columns. This can be a very straightforward way of addressing the large amounts of data that corporations have to deal with. They are not replacements for traditional databases, but they certainly a powerful way of performing highly aggregated analysis. I think Apache Cassandra is one of the most popular open source columnar databases that is widely adopted by many Fortune 500 companies. Now, both relational and columnar databases require you to define a schema before you can store anything. If your requirements change over time, you may need to add additional columns or perhaps change the data type of one of them. What if you have e-commerce application with thousands of products? Different products usually have a different number of attributes. Managing thousands of attributes in relational databases is inefficient and can slow down your database. This is ideal use case for the document database. You can store a product with all its attributes in a single document. It simplifies management and improves the reading speed. And if you change the attribute of one product, it won't affect others. So, what is document database? Well, it's a type of database used to store and query data in JSON-like documents. JSON is a data format that is both human and machine readable. Developers can use JSON documents in their code and save them directly into the document database. Flexible, semi-structured, and hierarchical nature of documents and document databases allows them to evolve with the needs of application. Let's take a look at the structure of JSON documents. JSON represents data in three ways. The first is the key value pairs. These pairs recorded within curly braces. The key is a string, and the value can be any data type, such as integer, decimal, or boolean. For example, a simple key value pair is year 2024. Next is the array. Array is an ordered collection of values defined within left and right brackets. Items in the array are comma separated. For example, fruit, apple, and grapes. And finally, objects. Object is a collection of key value pairs. Essentially, JSON documents allow developers to embed objects and create nested pairs. For example, address, country, USA, and state, Texas. Now, here's an example of a JSON-like document that describes a film dataset. You can see that the JSON document holds simple values, arrays, and objects quite flexibly. You can even have array with JSON objects within it. Document-oriented databases allow you to create unlimited level hierarchy of embedded JSON objects. It's entirely up to you what schema you want to give to your document store. Now, let's talk about the operations that you can perform on a document database. You can create, read, update, and delete entire documents stored in the database. Document databases provide a query language or API that allows developers to run these operations. Okay, first you can create documents in the database. Each document has a unique identifier that serves as a key. Then you can use API or query language to read document data. You can run queries using field values or keys. You can also add indexes to that database to increase read performance. And finally, you can update existing documents flexibly. You can either rewrite the entire document or update individual values. So what are advantages of document databases? The first thing that comes to mind is ease of development. JSON documents map to objects, a common data type in most programming languages. When building applications, developers can flexibly create and update documents directly from the code. This means they spend less time creating data models beforehand. As a result, application development becomes more rapid and efficient. Next, there is a flexible schema. A document-oriented database allows you to create multiple documents with different fields within the same collection. This can be handy when storing unstructured data, like emails or social media posts. However, some document databases offer schema validation, allowing you to impose some restrictions on the structure. Another advantage is performance at scale. Document databases offer built-in distribution capabilities. You can scale them horizontally across multiple servers without impacting performance, which is also cost-efficient. Also, document databases provide fault tolerance and high availability through built-in replication. If you want to try it out, MongoDB is the great option. It's the most popular open-source document database available. Easy to start with, has SDKs for most languages, and has a large community. Have you ever seen a detective board in the movies with pictures, news articles, and notes connected by thumbtacks and yarn? Immediately, you can see the power of connecting the dots in all of those relationships. Imagine taking that detective board and applying a mathematical engine that could query its data relationships. Well, that's a graph database. I want to explain graph databases by starting with relational databases. One of the main traits of the relational database is constraining nature of its relationships, which makes it ideal for processing transactions. However, these strict constraints often make it too complex to answer questions about distant relationships. Imagine you had all the university professor and student data ever collected. Then imagine you want to know the relationship between a group of 10 students originating from completely different universities. Well, at first glance, you would think that since the students didn't go to the same universities, they really don't have a connection. But if you look at their professors, we can discover that they all shared a common professor when they were students. So now let's zoom in and describe some of the traits of graph database. First, you have nodes, which are essentially records. Connected to those nodes is a type of relationship, which can have a direction and property associated with it. So in our case, the direction points from the original professor. The relationship type is a student of, and property is the year and semester where they were taught. Now, querying this database isn't like your typical SQL query. Graph database vendors often have their own query language, so this is something that the industry is still working out. You need to be very careful with graph databases because they can infer connections that don't actually mean anything. For example, imagine the inference you could make if all the students in our previous example ended up dropping out of school. Does that mean that original professor had some kind of meaningful impact on that bad outcome? Well, anything is possible, but we have to be a little bit more skeptical of such conspiratorial patterns. So, graph databases are usually a mechanism for starting questions, but not necessarily answering them. So what we see is data science community using graph databases to test inferences. The discovery of these relationships and their relevance to the organization often is what gets bubbled up into data warehouses, thus closing the loop. One open source graph database that I can suggest is ArangoDB. Now, information comes in many forms. Some information is unstructured, like text documents, pictures, videos, and audio, while some is structured, like application logs, tables, and graphs. On the other side, we have vector databases that store data as high-dimensional vectors. Each vector has a certain number of dimensions, ranging from tens to thousands, depending on the complexity of the data. Now, we can apply some kind of transformations to the raw data. We can encode all type of data in vectors that capture the meaning and context of the asset. This allows us to find similar assets by searching for neighboring data points. Vector search methods enable unique experiences, such as taking a photograph with your smartphone and searching for similar images. You can also find documents that are similar to a given document based on their topic and sentiment, and find products that are similar to a given product based on their features and ratings. In just a few examples, you can try Mivus, which is open source vector database. Now, let's talk about key value database. It stores data as collection of key value pairs, where a key serves as unique identifier. Both keys and values can be anything, ranging from simple objects to complex compound objects. The document database is a special type of key value store where keys can only be strings. Also, when querying your document store, you can read the entire value or a part of the value, especially if the value is in another JSON object. For example, you can have book ID 1 and price $10. Then query book price and the database will return the value 10. Key value databases always return the whole value, including both ID and price information. There are a few advantages of key value databases. The first is scalability. Most key value databases can scale horizontally and automatically distribute data across servers to reduce bottlenecks at a single server. Then there is ease of use. Key value databases follow the object-oriented paradigm, allowing developers to map real-world objects directly to software objects. Unlike relational databases, key value databases don't have to perform resource-intensive table joins, which makes them much faster. Now, let's talk about use cases. First is session management. Session-oriented application, such as web application, starts a session when a user logs in and remains active until the user logs out or session times out. You can use it for shopping cart. E-commerce website may receive billions of orders per second during the holiday shopping season, so you need a high-performance database. You can also use it for metadata storage engine. Your key value store can act as underlying storage layer for higher levels of data access. And caching. You can use key value database to store data temporarily for faster retrieval. If you need reliable key-value database, you can take a look at etcd. Kubernetes uses etcd to store all its cluster data, such as pods, deployments, and services. And finally, let's take a look at time series databases. As the name suggests, it's optimized for time-stamped or time series data. Time series data are simply measurements of events that are tracked, monitored, downsampled, and aggregated over time. This could include server metrics, application performance monitoring, network data, sensor data, events, clicks, trades in a market, and many other types of analytics data. It's used over traditional database types because it enables fast data retrieval and it is a cost-effective storage solution for that type of data. One example of general-purpose metrics database is InfluxDB. We also frequently use Prometheus to collect time series data from infrastructure. Prometheus is also a time series database with additional features to query targets such as VMs and Kubernetes pods. Each database type has its specialty. Relational for structured data and ACID compliance. Columnar for analytics. Document for unstructured data flexibility. Graph for complex relationships. Time series for time-stamped data. Vector for AI and ML scenarios. And key value for simple, fast data access. Using the right database type can be a game changer for performance, and the wrong one can slow down your queries and be very expensive. If you want to learn about relational databases and SQL joins, you can watch this video. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next lesson.